So welcome you all in the first session of second day's program, second day's 1 week faculty development program. Today we have very special guest, resource person, Professor Bhartendu Singh. Sir, Professor Bhartendu Singh is a professor and former head of department in the Department of Commerce, Mizoram University. He has done his bachelor, master and PhD degree in commerce from Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. After completing his PhD on topic Bombay Stock Exchange and appraisal of its working, sir started his academic career as a lecturer at Avadhoot Bhagwan Ram Degree College, Sonbhadra, Uttar Pradesh. Professor Bhartendu Singh has rich experience of 20 years and has published several research papers and book chapters in national and international journal of repute and in edited books. He has also authored 5 books in his long prosperous career. Dr. Bhartendu Singh has presented research papers in several national and international seminars, conferences, and workshops. He has also delivered keynote lectures in several conferences. Sir is reviewer of many national and international journals of repute. Professor Bhartendu Singh has been serving numerous committees in Mizoram University. He is a member of Board of Studies and a school board in several other universities. Sir is reviewer of many international journals in the area of commerce and management. He has been very active in guiding academicians, research scholars, and students having interest in the area of commerce, management, and finance, and thus has delivered several lectures as a resource person in several orientation programs, refresher courses, conferences, and workshops. His expertise is in finance, stock market, and entrepreneurship. I, Dr. Pankaj Kumar, on behalf of Department of Tourism and Hospitality Management, Mizoram University, have privilege to welcome Professor Bhartendu Singh in 1 week AICT Atal Faculty Development Program. Sir is going to deliver a lecture to us today, and he is going to talk on infrastructure and investment in tourism and hospitality sectors in India. So now I would like to request sir to deliver a lecture on this topic. So now over to you, sir.
Thank you for a very, very nice introduction. I don't know how far I fulfill those things. But I will try to justify what you have told. So, as he mentioned that I am going to deliver a lecture on tourism. No, it will be just sharing my experience with you. Because most of you may be academically more strong in tourism sector, because I am not from a tourism background. But as you know, we all are travelers, we all are tourists. Actually, we are on our voyage in this world. We came from some other world and now we are here as a tourist only. We are staying on earth as a destination only. And after visiting the places, after enjoying our pleasure trip, we'll go back to some other place. So we all are on the tray, on the tourism trip only. So on that line only, I will share my experience, what I have seen or what I read earlier. And then for preparation of this interaction also, I studied many things and many new things actually I come to know about tourism, which I was not actually knowing. So that was an experience for me also to know about the tourism from some formal way. And the topic given to me was, Himanshu sir requested me to deliver a topic or interact on the topic infrastructure. Somehow we feel that infrastructure is part of commerce. As he introduced, I'm a teacher in Department of Commerce of Mizoram University. So I'm supposed to see things from a perspective of commerce, from perspective of trade, from perspective of how things can be sold or purchased, how services can be delivered, how products can be developed. So these are actually my area, not pure tourism. So I will try to incorporate my commerce things with the tourism part. And actually, no one can say that he is not having exposure to tourism. We all are tourists, as I told already. So now let's see. I'll share something with you. I hope it will not go 1.5 hour, maybe a little lesser than that. So let's see. So am I audible, na? Himanshu ji? Anyone, I'm audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That is the problem with online. We are unable to know whether we are audible or not, whether we are visible or not. So if audio is going or slides are not seen, then just inform me. Na? Just inform. Otherwise, I will keep on speaking and I will not be knowing this. Okay, then. So I'll go for the screen share and we'll talk over this. If anyone is having any question, they may put it in chat box. No Q&A here, so chat box you may put, and we'll see if it is possible for me to go through the questions during presentation. I will try to take up. Otherwise, Rajdeep or someone else will taking up the questions later on. Okay. So I'll go for screen share now. So the topic I was given is infrastructure and investments in tourism and hospitality sector of India. And as already introduced to you, I am Bhartendu Singh from Department of Commerce, Mizoram University. And this picture, I hope most of you must be recognizing. This is a Google picture only, Google Earth picture, satellite picture of Ram Setu. And you may be thinking why I'm using this particular picture here and why I'm using same thing behind me also. So when I was thinking about talking on this, on infrastructure in tourism, so this thing came to my mind. As I told, we all are tourists. We came from some place, we are here, we are accommodating in Earth, and then again we'll go back to our main place. So we are tourists. Like that, same thing happened, we know about Ramayana. So this is very much on that line. And what I feel is, although that was not a tourism, obviously, very sure that was not a tourism, but travel was involved there, a very long travel from northern part of India to southern, deep southern part of India, and then going beyond country, going to Lanka, Sri Lanka. And in between, sea was there. And it is supposed that this bridge was built by him and his followers. So infrastructure, travel was there from this part to this part. And infrastructure was required to go for this. This is Rameshwaram and this is Sri Lanka. And this was a sea. So a route was required to go. And that was the reason why I choose this particular picture, just to show tourism, travel and relation with infrastructure. So we go further. If you see the tourism, it is a very, very ancient phenomena. We cannot say simply that it started in the last 10, 15 years or 20 or 200 or 300 years or 2000 years only. It is very long. I gave example of more than 5, 6 years, thousands year back. Now, if you see a little more closer, when if you see the ancient time, tourism or travel, it was not very complicated kind of thing. It was simple. Someone wants to visit the place, maybe for commerce, maybe for some new knowledge, maybe just to explore the place, or maybe trade and commerce, whatever be the case, they decide and they used to travel. No visa, no passport, no such formalities were there. It was very simple affair. But infrastructure was not there. Very difficult to travel. Now, it is easy to travel, but difficult to fulfill formalities. So during that period, it was largely unconscious and very simple affair. If you see the Indus Valley civilization, very long back, how they made roads, you can see on this picture. It is not original picture, obviously. It is just demarked on the like this only. So you can see road constructions are there, seaways are there, waterways, water tourism or transport is there. And but mostly during that period, travel was not for pleasure. Now, when we talk about tourism, we only feel it is for pleasure. But initially, it was not for pleasure. It was It was for some other purposes, like merchants were traveling for trade and commerce. People for pilgrimage purpose, they used to travel long, long places. And there were scholars in search of new knowledge, they used to travel. And out of these all things, trade and commerce was the main reason why people started traveling from one place to other place. If you go a little further, if you go to Babylonian development, then more than 2,000 years before Christ, that era were able to develop currency and transactions were there, and trade and commerce started there. And it is supposed that it is expected, it was in literature, it is showed that there were some travelers during that period who used to pay for transportation. So paid transportation was there up to some extent, obviously. And paid accommodation was also provided during that period. So we can say that some formal kind of tourism actually started during those period when money started, when currency exchange started, and the trade and commerce started. More than 2000 years BC. And it is read, it is written in many places that the rulers of ancient Babylonia were having protected roads and built rest houses. During those period, they built rest houses at many places for the persons who are traveling on road, who are passing by the place. So they need some shelter to stay, and some rest houses were prepared for them. And roads were also constructed the period. And obviously, for rest houses, they might have charged also. So a paid kind of traveling started during that long period. But again, it is not that kind of tourism what we used to understand now. If you see, whatever be the reason they are used to travel, they were exploring mainly for commerce, for trade, for new knowledge, or for some other reasons also. You see, Alexander, he traveled a very long route. We see Marco Polo, he traveled many places in many phases. And these two persons or persons like these can be considered as the pioneers in the field of modern travelers. They were the travelers by their nature. They started, and for years, they actually remain in the traveling part. If you see for India, Alexander is very known name for him. As invader, he came from some other place to invade in India to capture. Then not only for capturing, there are some other purposes also to visit, like travelers like Vasco da Gama. He traveled from far, far from Portugal and came to India by sea route. If you see on this chart, is this graph, this is Portugal from where he started, and he came, just crossed whole of Africa, took a circle of Africa, and then came to India, and then he returned back by from the same route. So he was supposed to be the first person to travel to India through sea route. Likewise, many others, like many Arabs, many Europeans came to India to establish mostly trading posts. Columbus was actually started travel to India only. He was intended to come to India, but he missed, and he actually discovered a whole new world. Reached the US. These all are actually part of travel only. If you talk about India, why people used to come to India is mostly because of either trade or commerce or education. India was the center of education since long. Nalanda University was there. And for trade and commerce also. India is considered to be a country of fabulous wealth. The trend continued and became more marked in course of time with Europeans heading towards Indian shore for sole purpose of trade and commerce. So mostly it is trade and commerce they came. If we talk about pleasure travel, a travel for pleasure, not just for trade or commerce, or not just for search of new knowledge. If you see tourism from point of view of pleasure travel. Mostly by tourism we understand that purpose only, that it is for pleasure, just to pass some time and enjoy the life away from our own home place. So if we talk about, if you see tourism from that point of view, then we can attribute this to the Roman Empire. During that Roman Empire, pleasure travel started, and they started taking up tours for pleasure, purely for pleasure purpose only. And the stimulus, the thing from where they got this is their good communication system and security. They had very good communication system, infrastructure, and security, another part of infrastructure. So these two things they had, and that gave a stimulus to them to go for pleasure trips. At the time of Roman Empire, roads in their period was very good. They were used to prepare, construct roads, and wherever they went, they used to construct roads. So infrastructure, they paid attention towards infrastructure. And later on, because they were trying for pleasure tourism, spas and seaside resorts during that period started coming up during the medieval period, 1500 AD or so. By the year 1865, there were major seaside resorts in Britain, France, and few more countries of Central Europe. So these were actually outcome of this Roman Empire, that impact of Roman Empire, the demand for spa, seaside resorts. And finally, these can be attributed as vacation travel. Okay. Now, this is another reason or another motivator for tourism, that is religion. And we know that during that medieval period and before that, tourism was other than trade and commerce, religion was one of the reasons why people used to travel long places just for religious purpose, just to pay as a pilgrimage only. So these four pictures is known to everyone, so no need to explain those pictures. People want to visit these places. Think of some 15th century or like that, when infrastructure was not very good. During that period, people used to travel these long phases and paid their pilgrimage there. If you see during this period, I'm talking about the medieval period, travel was mostly for religious motivation. Pleasure travel was not that dominant during that period. Trade and commerce was there, and that was obviously there. Primary thing was trade and commerce. But other than that, religious travel started during that period, and it was more frequent than for pleasure purpose. Nowadays, mostly it is for pleasure purpose, but during that period, it was religious more. Then a thing which came, which gave a big jump for the tourism was annual holidays, which started actually in Europe, which encouraged many people to undertake travel in large number during 18th century. The annual holiday was the forerunner to the paid holidays. Paid holidays is a different concept, and annual holidays is a different concept. Annual holidays, they used to get holiday, and during that holiday, they may travel to some places. And paid holidays, it will come later, where they used to get pay also for traveling. And because of this holiday, annual holidays, actually tourism took place. Because if people are on leave for 1 month or so, or 20 days or 30 days, they want to visit some places. Maybe some nearby places, if time is less, if budget is less, maybe nearby place. If time is more and budget is there, then they may go for further places also. Then came Industrial Revolution. And that changed the landscape of economy. Everything changed during that period. I'm talking about second half of the 19th century when this industrialization started. And travel before Industrial Revolution was mainly a matter of seeking knowledge. As many times I told, that main thing was knowledge, getting knowledge, and engaging in some sort of trade and commerce and pilgrimage. Mostly these three things. But after Industrial Revolution was what happened is everything changed in economic and social system. People started coming to the cities, main places where factories are being established. Big colonies were established there. They were having money in their hand, liquid cash in hand. They were having some holidays. And because of that society, that many people staying in many a very small place, coming from different places, they are not having very much good relation with each other because they were not knowing each other. And they were from far other places, their language different, their culture is different. They may not be getting that much of mix with each other. So travel become one thing, tourism become one thing for them to take up. So we can say that industrialization is considered as responsible for growth of modern tourism. Then came this railway. And that railway has changed a lot for the tourism, because before that it was very difficult to travel long places. But now with the advent of the railways, actually tourism become very easy and within reach of people. It was introduced in the 19th century. There was a train passenger were first carried by train in 1830 in England. The railway track between Liverpool and Manchester in England featured special provision to carry passengers in addition to freight. During one of this visit, one person was there, a Baptist preacher of Derbyshire, was on his way to a temperance meeting in Leicester. When he was inspired with an idea of engaging a special train to carry the friends to society from Leicester to attend a quarterly delegate meeting. Think of those periods, 1980, 1830, 40, that period. He was traveling for some religious purpose only, but in the way this idea came to his mind that why don't I took my friends and hire a train, charter a train, book a train and travel together for that particular meeting, delegate meeting. And the man behind this was Thomas Cook. Thomas Cook is a very known name, you must all be knowing. Now, a travel agency is there with the name of Thomas Cook. So, he was the person who was traveling this. He discussed this idea with his friends. And very soon, about 570 passengers made the journey by the this country railway to at reduced price, because a bulk booking is there. So, price was comparatively cheaper. And they traveled. And from there, you can say that traveling started for tourism purpose. This venture was followed by various excursions. In the year 1843, about 3,000 school children were taken to a trip from Leicester to Derby. From 1848 to 63, Cook conducted circular tours of Scotland with 5,000 tourists a season. Every season, 5,000 people were traveling with Mr. Cook. So this way, due to train, tourism started. The source of Liverpool, the success of Liverpool and Manchester Railway opened in this 1830, encouraged many other countries in Europe to start railway lines. And they started doing it. It happened in France, it happened in Austria, in Switzerland. And even in America also, they started putting railway lines and running railways over this. So overall, what we can say is when this train railway line came, that gave a big stimulus for travel. The charges, the tourism expenses become a little lower as compared to others. And it was a little easier also to travel. So people started traveling after railways. If you see the history of railway in India, we all know that the first train traveled on 16th of April 1853 between Boribandar, Bombay to Thane. It is nearly 34 kilometer distance. And it was operated by three locomotives at that time. So that thing started from there. But at that time, still there was a problem. The problem is still people were not able to take very long travel with train. The reason was if you are traveling for 3-4 days, now we can do it very easily. But during that period, it was very difficult because toilets were not there. And the food catering system was not there in the train during that period. So people used to travel for 4 or 5 hours in one stretch. Then they have to take a halt overnight or whatever. Then again, new trip. So that was a problem during that period. And you might have come across this letter in news media. Many times people send me on WhatsApp. This is a letter written by someone named Akhil Chandra Sen in 1909 to Sahibganj Division Office, West Bengal, complaining about a train when he went to a toilet on railway station. TT whistled it and train started and he ran, but he fell down and he couldn't catch the train. And he made a very big complaint over that. If you read this language, I'm just stopping here so that you can, if you have not gone through this, you can go through this, read this letter. It's a very interesting letter. And it is usually circulated as a joke, but it is not a joke. It is the real letter. This picture has been, this board has been put there. You can go there and take a picture of that also. And because of this particular complaint, actually toilets were introduced in Indian Railway. Now think, you are traveling to Kolkata to Mumbai or Delhi to Chennai. And if you assume that there is no toilet in the train, how difficult it is to travel. Mr. Akhil Chandra Sen was the person behind this. He complained for this and railway department started thinking what to do. And then many things came in the railways. And this is one of this. This is, I hope you must have recognized this. This is the Palace on Wheels. This is one coach of a train, Palace on Wheel. It is not a drawing room of some king. It is a railway coach only. So think of Akhil Chandra Sen's period when there was no toilet and see this phase when this kind of travels are there. So a lot of change has happened in this and that has actually increased tourism a lot more. If you see the sea tourism before, if you have to travel within in country, then train was there. But if you have to go beyond your country, if you have to go from India to some other country, then trains used to travel only in territory, in country territory only. If you have to go beyond, sea transport was there. So you have to take a ship, a steamship. This picture is of Titanic. You must all be recognizing it, although this picture is not very relevant here because in the first trip it sank. A negative thing was there associated with this in 1912. But when we talk about sea transport, we cannot forget about Titanic. So I thought this iconic photo should be there in my our discussion today. This is the original picture of Titanic. Now came the paid holiday and mass tourism. Now that is important phase started from here when people started getting payment for going on holiday. What we are getting reimbursement of our travels, LTC, leave travel assistance. So that kind of thing started. And if you are going on travel, still you are getting your pay. And now you are getting reimbursement for that also. This is a big stimulus for going on travel. And because of that, actually mass tourism started. Earlier, tourism was going alone, one or two person only in small numbers. But because paid holidays were there, the reimbursements started later on, not initially, later on reimbursement also started. That gave a big push to tourism. Now, why I'm talking all these things? Because these all things involve some sort of infrastructure, some sort of investments are there. Sometimes it is from employer side, government side, giving paid holidays, reimbursement facilities. Sometimes it is from government side, construction of railway sites and all those things. So these are all gradually happened. This is still is not very soon. It is started in 19th century. Now, if you see, even wrong things are having some good impacts. There is the impact of war on transport system. If you see Second World War period, at that time many infrastructure came up only because of preparation for war. For war, what governments have to do, they have to have transport, ammunitions, food, medicines, and soldiers from one place to other place. What they need is road for road transport, and for even quicker and heavier transportation, they need railway. So road and railway actually improved during this war period. Even air transport also started during that period, because if you see, if Britishers were in India, they have to travel by air only to come here. So all these three infrastructure started developing because of war. War is not a good thing. But just to take up this war, they have to develop the infrastructure, road infrastructure, railway infrastructure, and air infrastructure. So all these things happened because of war, but war will not always go on. After some time, it will be certainly stopping. When the war was over, these infrastructure were utilized by people for travel and tourism. If a train, they started running for carrying ammunitions, for carrying soldiers, for carrying medicines and food items. After war, they will not take up. It will continue. Now those things will be used by the travelers, the tourists. Same thing for road also. Okay, so war, Second World War was having a very good impact on tourism after war, not during war. During war, no one was traveling, obviously, for many reasons. But after war was over, because this infrastructure came up, tourism took up. So this way we can say that is the good impact of war. If you see that by 20th century beginning, the tourists travel almost exclusively by rail and ship. As I told, if we are traveling within India, within a country, then railway line is there. And if you are traveling to another continents across, then you have to take sea road, so steamships. Roads were not very good that time, and vehicles, motor cars were not there. Motor cars were very limited, motors were there. And mostly it was used by the soldiers only, army people. But now, during this 20th century, early 20th century, motor started coming for public. And people started purchasing it. And then again, tourism industry started flourishing furthermore. Because now it became easier for people to travel within country. It is very difficult to travel everywhere with help of a train. And after train, earlier only bullock cart was there to travel. But now cars started. Then some bus, some coaches also started like this. So after that war period, now the road transport started because of this motor vehicles. Okay. Now if you see the transport, air transport, that has given a big rise to the tourism. Actually, there was a time when people used to go on tourism only because they want to avail flights from one place to other place. Only to travel by flight, they used to travel and go there one day, stay and come back, so they can experience flights. So that was the way that gave impetus, force, or stimulus for growth of tourism. If you see these two photos, one photo is of olden period, and the lower picture is for during this COVID time, when social distancing is there. Out of these three seats, only two seats are occupied, middle seats are vacant. Everyone is having mask, and no one is looking at each other. Everyone is looking here or there. So that is actually a bad period of tourism, last 6-8 months during this COVID period. Actually, the hard hit sector is transportation and tourism, because no one is willing to travel, take public vehicle. No one is willing to stay in hotel. So it has become very, very difficult to enjoy tourism during this period. And I doubt it will remain like this for another 6-8 months or maybe a year, that people will try to avoid, unless it is very urgent, unless it is very forcing. We will try to avoid traveling, especially for pleasure travel. Work-related things we cannot avoid, but pleasure trips people will be avoiding. that is going to be a big impact on tourism industry. What we were thinking of the growth for next 10 years or 5 years, what governments are planning, is going to be heavily impacted because of this. Many hotels closed down. Many of the hotels has been converted into quarantine center. And many of the employees of the hotels, they have started some other subsidiary work because they are not having their salaries proper. So they have to do something else. Cooks, because hotels are closed, restaurants are closed. Now what will they do? They are doing some other work. So a big impact is there on that. Anyway, come back to this. In the year 1952, two-class travel was started, business class and normal class, introduced, which was made possible by the large capacity of new aircrafts. So bigger aircrafts started coming. So more number of passengers were there. And if more number of passengers are there in one flight, in one board, then in that case, expenditure per head will be less. So that fare prices started coming down after bigger flights started flying. So that also had a very positive impact on airport transport. Now came the jet. And because of this jet, somewhere near 1960, jet plane came, and bigger flights, faster flights, and expenditure was now gradually, because flights were become bigger, so it became lesser. Now these better jet machines were able to take flights longer duration, so less stoppage in between, and faster flying was possible. If you see this photo, this is actually advertisement of some agency, airlines.org. I just took it from internet, and it is comparing 1941 air travel with 2018 air travel. And example is selling Boston to Los Angeles, travel between these two places. In 1941, cost was $4,810. Now it is $427, 10 times less, 10% only. During 1941, total time taken was more than 15 hours. Now it is 6 hours only. And during that period, there were 12 stops between Boston and Los Angeles, but now zero stop. It is direct flights are there. So these things are actually attracting people to travel more by air. Now, if you think, if you see journey by train, what happens? Actually, we enjoy the journey by train. We can see the things outside the railways window, and at the stations we can get down and see the place, visit the people, eat something, and all those things are possible. But in flight, that is not possible. Once it took off, you will be in air and you are able to see only clouds, nothing more than that. And when it comes down only, then only you will come back to your real life, isn't it? Somehow I feel air travels is not that joyful, except for initial 10-15 minutes and last 10-15 minutes. Food is somehow you can take only just to pass the time, you can take food. It is not very joyful, isn't it? So it is not, overall this journey is not very joyful. Now think again about this 15 hours journey. So you are wasting 15 hours of your day and only traveling, seeing nothing. But now only 6 hours. So that was a stimulus for growth. Now coming to infrastructure. So sound infrastructure is crucial for development of tourism in any country, whatever be the country we are talking about. In broad sense, infrastructure includes physical, legal, environmental, and mental amenities, which contributes to making the tourism products enjoyable, reliable, and sustainable. So physical infrastructure required, legal infrastructure required, environmental infrastructure required, and mental amenities also required. So let's see in next two slides, what does it mean? Physical infrastructure of direct relevance to tourism companies are the airports, seaports, inland road networks, mass transport systems, hotels, etc. So hotels, bungalows, spa, restaurants, and recreational facilities constitute the main tourism infrastructure, or you can say physical infrastructure. Destinations typically cater to different classes of tourists by having facilities that appeal to both average and high spenders. So these are the main physical infra parts of main physical infrastructure. Let's go to legal infrastructure and environmental infrastructure. Legal infrastructure covers responsible legislation, trustworthy enforcement authorities, and strong independent institutions, which provide tourists with comfort regarding their personal safety and security. Unless we feel we are secure in a place, we are not going to enjoy the place, isn't it? If some terrorist activities are going on, we cannot enjoy tourism in that place, isn't it? So first thing is, law and order must be good there. I should have faith in the government that nothing will happen to me in that place. I should be very faithful, very confident that no theft, no burglaries, no other crimes will be there with me if I am traveling. Then only I can enjoy the trip, isn't it? So legal infrastructure is very, very important. And there are different rules for different persons in different places. So before traveling to any place, it's always advisable to go through the rules, the laws of that land. If you are going to some other place, there are some countries where on arrival visa is there. You just get down there on the airport itself, you get your visa. Most of the countries you have to go there. There are a few countries where even you don't need passport, but there are some countries where you need to take visa in advance, and there are some countries where very difficult to get visa. This I'm talking about when we are traveling beyond our country. But sometime within our country also, we have to take care of some rules. Like if you want to visit Arunachal, if you want to visit Mizoram, you need a permission to travel. If it is a foreign country, person is coming, a special written orders required. But for even for Indians, they need to take ILP, Inner Line Permit. It is issued immediately. You come to the airport and airport authority people are standing there, and they will immediately issue. Within 2-3 minutes, you get your formalities done. But that papers are required, so that you have to be careful. So whenever traveling to any place, a new place, better to inquire, better to read about, better try to know about the legal infrastructure of the place. Now let's go see that environmental infrastructure. It has gradually gained importance with development of ecotourism. Now it's getting very popular, ecotourism. Tourists are nowadays sensitive to the concept of green economy, renewable energy, and natural beauty. Ecologically friendly tourists pay attention to source of energy production. If a hotel is there which is generating electricity by solar power, those hotels are being more preferred. There are many tourists who are preferring those kind of hotels which are generating their power, who are using natural resources for heating water or running electricity, then who are using the nature, the normal way of generation. So if you are having this additional feature, this solar energy, then there may be some travelers who prefer you than other hotels. Now then, the mental infrastructure. Mental infrastructure is all about the hospitality, which is very, very important. It belongs to the person to whom you meet first on the hotel desk, front desk, how he greets you, how he meets with you, then how the persons in the hotel behave with you at the time of serving you food or all other things. Then this also incorporates the person who is driving taxi where you are going, or the tourist guide. And not only these, even the public, general public. If you are going to a place, if you go to a well-known tourist place, the main difference I feel if I go to Shimla in Ridge area, I feel everyone is tourist there. I feel that there is no locals wandering. Everyone looks like a tourist, so I feel very safe. I feel everyone is like me only there. But if you see, if you go to a place where tourists are not going very frequently, then everyone will start looking at you. Everyone will be looking at you. Who are you? As if you are an alien, isn't it? So this we feel little uncomfortable in certain cases. So the places where already tourists are going, go to Goa, go to Sikkim, go to some pilgrimage sites like Banaras or Puri, So you will find that people are you will feel as if you are part of the city. Reason is people there are actually they are habitual of seeing foreigners. They are habitual of seeing tourists. So it is not a new attraction for them. So you will also feel as if you are in your own city, very normal. So these all together make mental infrastructure. So for that, actually, usually the initial stage of development of tourism in a particular area, this thing is greatly missing. And for that, many kind of training courses should be run for travel operators, tour operators, guides, and taxi, hotels, so that they will be aware how to treat the guests. And we know if infrastructure is good, then only tourism will develop. If infrastructure is not good, people will not be coming to the place. So it has to be all those four or five kind of infrastructure should be good there. Then only you can invite or you can attract people. But then one more thing is there. There are many things, there are many chances, there are many ways, there are many examples where actually we want to go because there is lack of infrastructure. I want to go for a place where in disturbance of technologies are there. Okay, wellness tourism, you can say. Stay in peace, so that you cannot be disturbed by the technology. No sound from vehicles, no horn, honking, and no other kind of pollution. Free flow of water is there by a river, sun is there. So that kind of place we want, not only myself, people used to prefer that places, isn't it? So why we are preferring, why people want to go at that places? Because infrastructure is less in that place. If you supply all sort of infrastructure in that places, that become like Mumbai only. That becomes overcrowded place from where you are coming. If you take, many of you might not have come to northeastern region of India. Mizoram also you might not have come. You must have read only about Mizoram. So after this class is, not only this class, after this course is over, just go to YouTube and search for videos of Mizoram, aerial views or road view or whatever, just view of Mizoram. And then you will be start feeling to come at least once in Mizoram. It is not because of the great infrastructure available here. It is not because big buildings are there. It is not because some resorts are there or some tourist spots are there. No, it is only for the nature, trees, the greenery, the landscape, the beauty, what you will find here. That you can experience only in a place where infrastructure is a little lesser, where big buildings of Mumbai are not available, isn't it? So everywhere, don't feel that we need to supply all infrastructure everywhere. No, it is not there. Vaishno Devi. Many of you might have visited Vaishno Devi. One attraction for going to Vaishno Devi is walking 13 kilometers on hill, isn't it? Helicopter service is there, within 10 minutes it will drop you. But people still prefer going on walk. Okay? They want to go on that way. It is tiresome, but still it is joyful, isn't it? Kailash Mansarovar. It is very difficult, very, very, very extremely difficult to reach there. But people go there because of that only. Now you think that a flight is there which drop you there within 10, 15 minutes, half an hour. Then that kind of dedication what we are having in today's time, that you will lose because of infrastructure. Okay? So at some places we need infrastructure, more infrastructure, better infrastructure, developed infrastructure. But at some places not. Okay, so that should also be kept in mind, that what kind of infrastructure we need at what point of time. Okay. Okay, so we continue. There are some researches that shows that transport infrastructure is essential in raising the attractiveness of the destination. And obviously reason is, unless there is proper transportation, how to reach there? We cannot go on walking. If you want to go Cherrapunji, that wettest place on earth, most rains are there nearby Cherrapunji area. If you want to see that and there is no roads, if there is no flight, there is no train, there is no road, how will you reach there? You cannot walk 500, 600 kilometers. although people recently walked this much long period during this lockdown, COVID lockdown, but that was an extreme case. For tourism purpose, no one will walk these long period, isn't it? So we need some basic infrastructure must be there. So one attraction is availability. Okay, so comfortable air connectivity to and from a destination reduces pressure on airfare. If good number of flights are there, then airfare usually comes down because of the competition. Many flights are there, so they have to reduce their price, and that becomes within reach of everyone. Okay, and number of seats will also increase. A good road network ensures access to remote tourism sites at a reasonable price. Future research may be estimate the specific contribution of different types of infrastructure to the growth of tourism industry. Now let's see the tourism infrastructure model. There are some questions are coming, but anyway, I'll take it later on. So let's see this model. These are from where we can get investment. It may be equity capital investment by the entrepreneur, or maybe directly by the government. It may be a credit. You are taking loan from bank or some other places. It may be a grant from government in form of subsidy, or it may be granted in cash, or it may be a funding from financial institutions. So, or maybe some other sources possible. So from these sources, finance will come, and this will go in these two places. It will go to commercial entities, and it may go to public entities. Public entities means government-owned entities. Okay. And these two together may form some public-private partnership. So public-private partnership, PPP, means where government and public, means private bodies, these two come together to form a platform for infrastructure development. And these commercial entities will invest in commercial infrastructure. Commercial activity entities means some travel agencies, maybe tourist destination developments, guides, and all those things where private bodies are involved, not government bodies. So these commercial entities, who are obviously working only for profit motive, their main motive is profit, but they can earn profit only by serving people. So these two things they have to take together. So commercial entities, they invest in commercial infrastructure, and public entities, they invest in public infrastructure, road construction. Road construction will not give money back to government except for toll, which goes for years. Bridge, construction of bridge, huge investment is there, but money will not come back immediately in direct form. Infrastructure, telephone or mobile network connectivity, all those things, railway, laying railway line, all these things, huge investment required, and there is no direct return of that money. So public entities usually invest in this public infrastructure, and this private public partnership may also invest in public infrastructure, which may be available to other parties. Okay, and these two together form touristic product of the region. Okay, so this may be the flow of the finance. This model is not developed by me. While reading a book, I got this model, and I try to explain it in my words, in my style. Similarly, this is another model on resources for development of tourism. It may be natural resource assets, it may be human asset, human made asset, it may be labor, capital, or capacity. And these are the other parts: terrestrial features, marine features, wildlife, all those things under natural asset. Human made assets is cultures, customs, history, buildings, structures, and all those things what are made by man. Then labor, productive services, capital, on equity investments, and experience, knowledge, capacity. Now let's see some stages of destination development. And usually you will find this kind of lifeline for a life cycle of a particular destination. Okay, number of tourists and time. Over the time, number of tourists will gradually increase, then rapidly increase, then it will reach at a point where there is difficult to grow, or it will very small grow, is there growth is there, and then it will start declining. At this stage, unless that destination reinvents itself, it has to die, it will finish. Okay, but the cycle is usually very long if you are able to maintain it. So let's see these all five stages one by one. We'll go a little fast. So first is discovery stage, when a new place is being identified. A destination Vegans has a relatively unknown place, because it is a new place, it is unknown place, and visitors initially come in small numbers, few only will come, and access will be difficult there, facilities will be obviously very less there, and they will not be having any local knowledge. So these things will be lacking there, but gradually people will start coming. Then stage two will come, where it will grow. So some sort of infrastructure will come, and people will discover the destination, the word spread by mouth, people will talk. If I visited that place, I will tell it to my friends, my family, my relatives. And among them, few of them may decide to go there. So gradually it will spread. About its attraction and amenities are increased and improved gradually. So that is development stage. And now number of tourists will increase. Then stage of stagnation will come. Usually it comes a little longer if a place is good. It is just before maturity or about to be mature, when many people are going there, tourist arrivals in very big numbers, the people are going there. Usually they are going beyond their full capacity. If you go to sea beach of Goa during December last week up to 15th of January, then you will find there is no space to sit, because huge number of people are there, mass tourism. Now, if you read some travel magazines, you all must be reading those travel magazines more than me. Now, in Goa, people are talking about alternative, some other, not only during that 15-20 peak hours, travel in some other time, so that you can enjoy your trip. Actually, you get your hotel easily. In December, it is very difficult to get hotel. You have to book in September or maybe in August to go there. If you want to go to Shimla by train, you have to book your tickets 3-4 months in advance. Otherwise, you don't get ticket for that. So huge crowd is there, already identified places. So that is the problem with the tourism after some time, where they start serving more capacity than what they could. So usually it happens towards before the decline phase starts. In decline phase, increased congestion and unsustainable development cause the reduced resources that originally drew visitors to the destination longer exist. So attraction usually starts going, because of huge people going to the place, it is difficult to cater, difficult to serve them, and gradually that place attraction starts declining. And then the last thing, rejuvenation comes. Here, technological developments or infrastructure improvements leading to increased carrying capacity can help revive a destination. If these things are not happening, then it will die, or it will start declining, it will reduce, or gradually it will go out of the tourist map. So usually this kind of shape you will find in most of the tourist spots. Now, there are two big projects which are going run by our central government for encouragement of tourism. One thing is Swadesh Darshan. They call it Swadesh Darshan. It is integrated development of theme-based tourist circuits. So these 15 circuits has been identified by government, and they are giving funding for different places. States may apply, or some other parties, designated parties, may apply for these funding under these circuits, and that can be developed. It may be Buddhist circuits, coastal circuits, desert circuit, ecotourism, heritage, Himalayan circuit, Krishna circuit, Northeast circuit, Raman, rural circuit, spiritual circuit, Sufi circuit, Tirthankar circuit, tribal circuit, and wildlife circuit. All those 15 items or 15 schemes have been identified. If you want detail of all those schemes and how many projects have been funded already under these schemes, you can go to the reports of tourism ministry, and all details are given there with project names. Another important thing which started in last 5-7 years is the scheme called Prasad. Prasad is actually acronym for National Mission on Pilgrimage, Rejuvenation and Spiritual Augmentation Drive. These words has been acronymed as Prasad, and it started in 14-15, financial year 14-15. So this is the number of projects funded by under this project. So nearly 30 have been funded so far, 28 to be specific. If you want detail where these things are going on, even some projects in Mizoram also has been running on these lines, and previous project has been already sanctioned. And if you want to know about other details, you can go to the annual report and you will get all details where it is getting, how much fund is there, how much released and all those things. Okay. Now, let's see something on Northeast. We are sitting in Northeastern region of India. So let's see some road infrastructure. I tried to search other infrastructure, but I found some interesting data, interesting infrastructure for road connectivity. Why only road I'm taking? Because railway is very less in whole of Northeastern region except Assam. Assam is quite well connected by railway, and up to some extent Tripura is also connected with railway. But other states, be it Arunachal, Nagaland, Manipur or Mizoram or Sikkim, Sikkim is not having any rail connection at all. Arunachal up to some extent only, Mizoram only 3-4 kilometers, although extension of line is going on, railway line is going on, but it will still take some time. So other states other than Assam and up to some extent Tripura, other states are not having good connectivity of railway. So difficult to compare, so I left it. Similarly, every state is having at least one airport except Sikkim. Sikkim also got one airport last year or last to last year. But because of extreme weather, in most of the time it is not functional. So you have to take nearby airport, which is in West Bengal. So otherwise, all states are having at least one airport. Arunachal also is missing. But road is a thing which is actually connecting all these states in Northeastern region. So let's see some road connectivity in Northeast. This is length of highways in kilometer. And these are given for all regions. It is not for states. It is given here for 6 regions: Northeastern region, Eastern region, Northern region, Western region, Central region, and South Indian, Southern region. And this is all India. But on average, it is not total. Total will go much longer. So I've taken it on average. And these are the year. First bar is 2011, then 12, then 13, and last is for 17. So if you see the last bar, how it is different in different regions in India. Northeastern region is the least. So road network within Northeastern region is, compared to other regions, are the least. Okay, although it is very close to Eastern region, but still it is lesser than that. Railway, I told, it is almost not existent except for Assam and up to some extent Tripura. And airports, almost every state is having one. With not too many flights, but still some connections are there. And road also is the least in Northeastern region. Now, if you see within region, the states, how different states are faring. So Sikkim, first one is Sikkim, then Tripura, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, Manipur, and Arunachal. And this is Assam. If you see that the height, this is Assam and this is Sikkim. No comparison, actually. A lot of disparity is there between these two, isn't it? Reason is the tough terrain. Assam is mostly plain with little hills only, gradual hills only, mild hills. But in Sikkim, और मेघालय और मिजोरम स्टीप हिल्स आर देयर सो डिफिकल्ट टू मेंटेन रोड्स. ओके लेट्स सी फर्दर. देन रोड लेंथ पर स्क्वायर किलोमीटर ऑफ द एरिया. इफ इफ यू डिवाइड लेंथ ऑफ द टोटल रोड विद इन स्टेट बाई द टोटल एरिया, एरिया ऑफ द स्टेट डिवाइडेड बाई लेंथ ऑफ टोटल रोड, देन दिस काइंड ऑफ चार्ट यूज टू इरेप्ट. दिस द लोअर पोर्शन इज फॉर मिजोरम ओवर 2007 to 16. Middle part is for northeastern region on an average for whole of northeastern region, and the bigger upper part is for all India level. If you see last year 2016 as per data available from road transport is for Mizoram it is 0.5, only half kilometer per square kilometer area. For northeastern region it is nearly 2, 1.93. But at India level, it is 3.1. So this also shows that road connectivity in northeastern region and Mizoram is less as compared to all India level. Again, reason is that tough terrain. Now the road of length. The previous one was highways. Now it is road length. Road length. If you see central region, eastern region, and northeastern region. Again, if you see these two are nearby then, but otherwise southern region is much higher than northeastern region. So a huge gap is available, is there in road length in kilometers within a state. Okay. Okay, let's go further. This is within state, within northeastern region. Previous slide was for northeastern region, for different regions. Hello, is it visible? No? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay. Then see this road in northeastern region itself. This is level of Assam. Last year is 2016, so I'm taking comparing with 2016 and compare this with Sikkim. This much huge difference. Mizoram, actually there is no comparison within region, within northeastern region. If you see railway connectivity, only Assam is having. Flight connectivity all states are having, but not many flights. And road connectivity, this is the situation. So a huge potential for development of infrastructure is there. That is very much required also, which is happening gradually. Rail line is under construction. Gradually it will happen, but as of now, huge gap is there between Assam and other states within Mizoram. Within northeastern region. Then this is the availability of power, electricity. How much electricity is available in northeastern region? This is last column is for India. This column is for India, and last column, if you see, it is for 17-18 year. In India, this is the level of power available, and in Assam, road connectivity was better, railway connectivity was better. But if you see within a region, Assam is having among the least in per capita availability of power. Mizoram is better than Meghalaya. Sikkim is the best. Okay, so one thing may be missing, but other thing is there in better number. So you can say regional disparity is there in power supply. This is power deficit. How much deficit is there? If you see the last year, deficit is decreasing over the year. If you see, deficit is increasing, decreasing. So that is a good sign. It means the production is increasing, supply of power is increasing. That's then only this deficit will reduce. So it is reducing rapidly. That is going very fine. But if you see, this is for whole of the middle part, this middle bar is for average northeastern region, then you can see that disparity is much more, this deficit is much more as compared to all India level. Anyway, Mizoram is much better than the rest of northeastern region. Okay, throughout the year it is happening like this. Okay, but if you see in 14-15, 15-16, everywhere this middle bar after this period is higher. But if you see this beginning, this period, these 3 years, Mizoram had higher deficit of power. But gradually things have improved here. Okay, now let's see some destinations. I'm almost now finishing my presentation, just maybe 2-5 minutes it will take more. And I will talk about, I will not talk about only, just only some pictures are there because it is tourism, so there should be some pictures. So, and when we talk about infrastructure, it is a confusing thing. What constitutes infrastructure? Just road, just airport, or just railway, or electricity, or hotel, or something more? So for that, let's see some pictures and let's try to identify what infrastructure we need. Different destinations need different kind of infrastructure. Same infrastructure is not required for all the things. Like if you see the infrastructure requirement in a desert, it is very much difficult. What we need is this kind of traveling. Weather's very frequent changes are there. In daytime, temperature is very high. In nighttime, temperature is very low because of this sand. It gets hot very soon. It gets cool very soon. So you need to capture that. Then wind is there. Then dust storms used to come there. So how to deal with all these things and hot temperature? You cannot travel long in this period. So how to maintain these things? That kind of infrastructure, that kind of setup is different. If you compare this with wetland tourism, I don't know is an accepted word or not, but I wanted to use wetland like Cherrapunji, which is considered as the most, where most rains occurred in world, not only in India, in world. It is now no more Cherrapunji. It is some place nearby Cherrapunji, but I'm missing that name. It is nearby in Meghalaya itself, nearby Cherrapunji. But it's not Cherrapunji now. But if not top, then it may be second. So here, lot of rain is there. In desert tourism, no rain is there. So we need different kind of infrastructure in these two places. Okay, same infrastructure, just same mindset will not work. If you see the pilgrimage tourism, this picture is from Varanasi. It is only because I am from there and it is known for pilgrimage, so I am using this picture. And health tourism. What we need for pilgrimage tourism is something else. Temples should be there and that safety should be there. And then it should be, we should be able to visit the places, boating or Ganga Puja or all those things, kind of things should be available there. But if we go for health tourism, a different kind of setup required. Health facility should be there, spa should be there, rest place should be there, massage parlor should be there, and obviously some health services should be there. So a different kind of infrastructure required for these two places. Same infrastructure will not help. If you go for mountain tourism, we need some equipments for hiking, for trekking and all those things, which is very much different from if you go for beach tourism. In beach tourism, we need life jacket, we need small boats, surf boards, and all those kind of things, isn't it? So the infrastructure we need for mountain is not at all required for beach tourism. Okay, so specific to the project, we have to think of the infrastructure. So basic infrastructure will only make you reach the destination by air or by road or by train, whatever be the way, but only to reach the place, or up to little more extent, staying in a place, hotel. Okay, but other things will be different. If you go to urban tourism, go to Mumbai or go to some developed cities, big buildings are there, fast transport is there, fast internet is there, all those things are there. Okay. But the person who want to go to this place are different, their requirements are different, their destinations, their taste is different. And if you go to agro-tourism, it is just reverse of that. No big concrete infrastructure, all greens are there. So the taste of the tourists are different, their needs are also different, and different kind of infrastructure required for them. Is okay? So different tourism destinations and different kind of infrastructure required. We have to think of that. Okay, I have not talked about one more infrastructure, which is very much required, is internet connectivity these days. As soon as we click a photo, we want to send it on social media. If I take a photo, I want to send it on WhatsApp to my friends or my my relatives. I want to upload it some videos on YouTube. I want to post it on Instagram. I want to send it on Telegram or many social, Facebook and all those things. Immediately, I am not able to wait for that. As soon as I click, I want to upload. I should be the first person. If a group of people are going, I should be the first person to click Taj Mahal. No one else should click that, isn't it? So that kind of thing. So that also is a thing which is required. Okay, go to marine tourism, underwater and in air, hot air balloon, different kind of infrastructure required for these two things. Is okay. So all tourism spots need a different kind of setup. And that's all for today's presentation from my side. So thank you for your patient listening. I hope it was a joyful journey with me. I'm not an expert in the field of tourism. What I discussed is only what I feel, what I have seen, what I have read somewhere. So with this, I'll finish my presentation. Thank you all for your listening.
Thank you very much, sir, for your detailed and elaborated lecture. I'm sure that we participants have received a lot of information from your lectures.
Thank you, thank you.
Sir, during this lecture, we have got a lot of appreciations for, regarding your presentation, and along with that, we have also received a lot of questions from many of the participants.
Okay, okay.
I don't think we will be able to take all the questions from the participants, but some of the questions I would like to discuss with you, sir.
Yes.
Sir, one participant is asking, like, the current crisis has totally crushed the prevalent theory of development or infrastructure development theory or tourism and hospitality development. So what is your opinion on a new set of theory of development? Do you think there is a need to change in development theory, or we should wait and watch for revival of the tourism and hospitality?
Theories are actually generated by practice only. What we are practicing after some time will become theory. So a new theory is coming up for sure. But what we can do is only wait and watch. Tourism industry is really the worst hit by COVID situation. And I hope it will continue for another 6-8 months. As I told in our discussion only also, that will continue. But we have to wait. We have to wait. We have to maintain the infrastructure what we are already having. It should not deteriorate, because you know that if tourists are not going, hotels are closed, it will deteriorate. So we have to maintain those things and wait for some time, and it will come. It is not the first time it is happening. This happening this time because of pandemic, but earlier it happened for some other reasons. For war, it happened in some places. For some other, during plague, if you see some 70, 80 years back, plague was the reason of this kind of thing. If you see from infrastructure point of view and investment point of view, 2008 period, Lehman Brothers Bank failed in US. So all those things are happening. It keeps on happening. Every 10, 15 years, a new kind of crisis will come. And we have to come out of this. So that will continue like this. So we have to wait. We have to watch. And we have to then again pack our bag and start for next phase of tourism.
Sir, another question is, as the Northeast and particularly the Mizoram has lot of potential for tourism development. The destinations are, the nature-based destinations are there, which is loved by the tourists from across the world. But sir, what are the roadblocks to tourism development here in Northeast? Is it mainly because of infrastructure development only, or that that people prefer destinations other than Northeast?
See, one thing, the bottlenecks are there, some things are there, knowledge, information. If you see from Mizoram, you're also in Mizoram only, you must be experiencing the thing. Before coming, if I share my own experience, I came in Mizoram first time in 2004, April. So before coming to Mizoram, my opinion or my idea about Mizoram was that where a place where political tension is there, political disturbance is there, and a place where tea gardens are plenty. This was my opinion. But as soon as I reach here, I realized that both the things were wrong. Mizoram is the most peaceful state in India. That is a well accepted fact now. Most peaceful state of India, not Northeast. Most peaceful in India. And I thought terrorism is there, political disturbance is there. So I was wrong. And I thought that plenty of tea gardens are there, but very less. So our knowledge actually for this region is very less throughout. You ask any person in the rest of India about northeastern region. They know up to some extent about Assam, but not much. For them, all states are Assam or part of Assam only, isn't it? So knowledge is one thing. And here I feel our government and tourism department, they should work hard in this area so that people come to know this place, about this place. Sometimes it happens when I talk to my friends or some other known person in other places. They get confused. Aizawl is in Mizoram or Imphal, in Manipur. Which state's capital is Aizawl? Even one of my known person, when I told I am in Mizoram University, he told in which state. So knowledge is the biggest problem in this. And then we need to change our mindset also within Mizoram. Language is a hurdle here. It is not Hindi is not very popular here, and most of the tourists need Hindi. But English people know here, so that is not a very big hurdle. Infrastructure is obviously there. Only one flight nowadays. Only one flight is there. Railway connectivity is almost nil. Road is there, but it is very long, and very twists and turns are there. So that infrastructure is a problem. Then destination development we have not done. There we are not having any place to show that come for this, isn't it? Come just to see Kanjiranga, just to come any name of that place is not there. So we have to develop some destinations. We are having very good destinations, but we have not developed that. We have not developed Rayak as a destination for outside Mizoram. People within Mizoram, they are attracted to Rayak. They are attracted to Mui Phang. They are attracted to other places. But outside Mizoram, people don't know. So who will come? So we have to develop some destinations, and we have to inform rest of the world that these things are available here. Then people will certainly come here. And then we need to change our mindset also. We should try to assume or receive tourists as income generator. They will stay here in a hotel, they will use a tourist guide or a taxi to travel, they will go to the place, they will take food, they will take tea. All those things actually expenditure coming to the state. Somewhere I was reading, anyway it is not very relevant to here, but somewhere I read that for one room of hotel, there are 1.6 person in India on an average. Isn't it? You might be having better knowledge than me in this lay. So every hotel room is having 1.6 employee. So see how much of employment is being generated by the tourism. If more tourists are coming, more hotels will be there and more employment will be there. Every room, 1.5% is getting job. Every hotel on an average is having 131 employees on an average throughout the country. So another new hotel means 130 new jobs. So we should start thinking in that direction. We should start thinking Tithi Devo Bhava, and that will help in improving the destination. Yes.
Sir, thank you, sir. Sir, another question is, as tourism and hospitality industry is mostly service-based industry, and another side we have tangible industries, you know, product for the product like tangible product are in tangible nature. While in tourism and hospitality industry, product are of intangible nature, and that is totally service-based industry. So what kind of enabling environment or enabling approach should be fostered for entrepreneurial development in tourism and hospitality industry?
Not only health tourism, whole tourism is actually service-based. Products are not there. Mostly it is service-based only. So we have to take that approach of service development, entrepreneurship development to, in service sector. I think Professor Jyoti Kumar will be talking on entrepreneurship. So he will be taking up all these issues, development of tourism from entrepreneurial activities in the field of tourism. So I will leave this question for him. Maybe he's having next lecture or already done?
It's already done.
Okay, it's already done. Okay. I thought mine is preponed, so his will be later. Okay.
Sir, one last question. Sir, in tourism, nowadays in present scenario, that the students are more focused towards getting a job. So what kind of approach we academicians should adopt to promote entrepreneurial mindset in our students?
That we have to show them the prospects of this field. It is not only whenever it is service, we have to touch the mind, not the body. We have to satisfy a person by their mind. If I go to a place, if I'm happy with the place, then I will go back and I will inform my friends. I will tell my colleagues, my relatives to go. If you are going to that place, go to that hotel only or hire that tourist guide only. So from that point of view, we have to think. We should not feel that usually there is one tendency that because this person is coming only once, so it's okay. He's already came to my hotel, already paid his rent to me. Then what? Whether he's satisfied or not, he has already paid the room rent. He's here for only one day. So that kind of thought we should not feel. We should feel that he is the person who is going to send 10 more tourists to my hotel. So that mindset, when you talk about tourism, actually it is a matter of mindset only. We have to change our thinking. Till the person who leaves the state, he should be our guest only. It is not only that fill it, shut it, and forget it, isn't it? So that mindset we have to teach, and how to satisfy, how to read the requirement or need of the tourists, and how to satisfy them. That thing we need to learn. Yes.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, one last question. Just Mr. Saket Rane is asking, please elaborate few points on what we should focus apart from infrastructure and development to make a good tourist destination.
What we develop in infrastructure? So then a whole lot of discussion what we did will go again. We have to unfold all those things because infrastructure is again, just 2-3 lines I will say. Infrastructure is not one destination based. All different destinations require different kind of infrastructure. But basic infrastructure, what is required is road connectivity or air connectivity so that people can reach that place. Then a place to stay healthy and safely, that should be there, means hotels should be there. Then some product development should be there. And that product means that tourism spot is a product in this case. So development of that should be there, and accordingly we have to choose what infrastructure, and internet connectivity is a must nowadays. So basically reaching there, travel, then staying there, and tourist guides and internet connectivity. Basically these four must be there, but then again other infrastructure required for different destination based.
Okay, sir, thank you very much, sir, for your giving us time and delivering such a wonderful lecture. So thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.